Yes, hello everyone. I'm Pastor Shaka Abraham, known as Clapton. I'm here to introduce to you something very special that I have been experiencing myself throughout my time in the 22 years of my salvation with Christ, and that is the revival of Uganda. A lot of things have been happening, and you know, I've been grateful through what God has been doing. Revival, as we know, revival or transformation, especially spiritual transformation, that is when we're talking about the nation having God in it. The glory of God, the presence of God in the nation, when everyone knows about the power and the mighty existence of our God. And throughout all this time, I've experienced Uganda coming from one level to another. And I have come here to tell you the keys of revival. One of those things are repentance, prayer, and the Word of God. And of course, revival comes through the waves, I mean different waves. And one of the waves is the wave of the fivefold ministry. All go through the waves of revival. So revival can go through the wave of evangelism, the wave of prophecy, the wave of pastorship, the wave of teaching, the wave of apostleship. And I've seen Uganda going through all these waves. And waves of revival also bring about prosperity. That is to say, a country can come out of poverty and go straight to another level. Like I've been writing in our magazine, revival, like the revival of Uganda, has really transformed the nation from different levels. One of those levels is the level of poverty. We have been called the papyrus churches, and now it has turned out the Uganda churches, the born-again churches, are now one of the topest churches in Uganda. These are some of the churches that I want to show you the pictures, and then you see for yourself. God bless you, as we are also inviting one of our young generation called Pastor Wilson Bugembe. He's one of those guys that God is using into the young generation to see the transformation of this country. I've seen him growing, I've seen him when he was young, and throughout his life, I've seen that God is transforming him, and this is the level where we are. So people want to hear from you. Speak to the life of that young man, and yeah, let's see what God can do for them. Pray for them.
I'd love to say thanks to Pastor Clapton for this opportunity.
Many people also believe if you're not rich, you cannot make it. So I want to hear from you, because we're one among the testimonies we have in Uganda that God has helped. So we want to hear a little bit of your background, any area you want us to hear. That's why we're here, to hear from you, so that this testimony can also bless specifically China. But we know you're blessing the world right now. Yeah, but we want to speak to the Chinese at this time. Thank you, Pastor.
Amen. I'm still overwhelmed by your story, like being a foreigner. Mm. You're no longer a foreigner now, but being a foreigner in China. God sent you to China, and there you are. God is blessing you to bless China and to bless Uganda. Mm. So I've known you for quite a long time, and so you're one of the guys that that inspired us. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad that that hand in you, mm-hmm. and people can scoop it out and also enjoy it. Yes. Literally, there's a song we used to say, "This is my story, this is my song. I'm praising my Savior, Daddy Love." I love that song. He touched me, Jesus touched me, and all the joy that floods my soul, something happened, and now I know He touched me and made me.
Oh, amen, amen.
He touched me because I lost my mom. And my dad, HIV, to AIDS. That was 1993-94. I became homeless. I became a street kid. I lived under a tree. I begged people for bread. I knocked on people's windows, car windows in traffic. Hey, mom, can you give me something to eat? When I was born with 5 boys, we had no girl. And my mom, in 1993, I was about 9. She got sick and she died. Yeah. 1994, my dad got sick too. And we didn't know what was happening. And so I was the biggest boy now, I was about 10. So my dad calls me in the room on his deathbed and says, Wilson, I know you are very young, but you need to hear this. I said, I am sick, I have AIDS, and I'm not going to get off this bed. I'm going to die. But I've given my life to Jesus. So we'll meet in heaven. And then he gave me a smile. And I was crying and I was very nervous because it was scary. It was really, really too small lady. But it was my father. Anyway. And so he said, but you are 5 and 3 of your brothers were born with HIV. So they will die. And it's just you and one who is not born HIV positive. But I will not tell you the name, so you can love them equally. And says, you're going to stay with relatives, extended family, but when you grow up, bring them all together. Then he said, hopefully you'll find the cure. Hopefully they will find the cure for HIV, so that your other brothers will be okay. And he said, I know they will find it. He said, I'm praying for you. And then he cracked a joke. He said, you know I'm going to God. I'm going to tell him. He cracked a joke. He said, when I meet God, I'll tell him to send a cure. And we tried to laugh about it. And then he died. And that was it. And that's when the wind was blown off our boat. That's when things began to be tough. Went with relatives. The guys who took me to a good school. Long story cut short, I ran away from that home because it wasn't really okay. So I started to stay in the streets and I lost hope. I lost hope because I had promised my dad that I'll take my other young brothers, siblings back to school. And they stayed with my grandpa and grandma. And one day I ran into the car because I wanted to commit suicide. I wanted to die. I was always saying, mommy, mommy, where is mommy? So, of course, no one wants to make an accident. Some people were dodging me. And besides that road was a guy called Patrick. Who saw me and grabbed me and gave me a hug. And I went to shop with tears. And he stopped the taxi, paid them money, took me to church. At church, after a week, I gave my story. And I had my songs. I used to sing songs. Songs of AIDS, songs of when you are low and lonely, you sing. So at Jagu, I sang a song, Jagu's called Trumpet Center. It was a journey with me. So I sang a song, they asked me what do you want, I said, I want to go back to school. So one church elder, Stefan Mbogo, took me back to school. The church gave an offering for my mattress, bed sheets, bed covers. Off we went to school. At school, I was lonely, I was always by myself, I was always thinking, I was always crying. Always students came to me and said, hey, it's going to be okay, it's going to be okay, it's going to be okay. And that's when you guys turned up. That's, remember, sin left school. I was a great Christian. Mm. I didn't like God. Because I felt like God was not on my side. He didn't really love us that much. We were so poor that even the poor people called us poor. You know, there were funerals and deaths and burials all the time. But my dad died. On his deathbed, he believed in Jesus Christ for eternal life. So at school, that's when preachers like you started coming. You were very young, but you were on fire.
Yes.
So we used to come, me and my friends, Philip, Wilfred, Ben, Joran, another team, Justin. We were a big group. Bukenya, Ronald, so you know, so many guys. At school, there was that fellowship for Christians. And preachers used to come in, preach and preach. Used to sing. And I remember that sermon he preached. Yes, Jesus loves me. And then you could talk, you know, Jesus loves you. And then you go, yes, Jesus loves me. And it was Dr. Sharma and you. So, and other preachers. But we were always at the back. But something that really touched me is these students were not the richest students. This wasn't the best school in the region. So students had issues. Some of them were orphans, poor, hungry. But every time they entered into that room to begin worshiping, you could see them smile, sing, as if everything was okay. I admired that. Maybe we had issues outside church, but every time they entered that room, which they called church, and played these local drums.
Yes, you're one of the best.
I wasn't a Christian by then. I was just a spectator.
Yeah, I remember very well, because some of the things maybe I remember, you don't remember, but they report to me in the news. You talk to him,
And I remember that song. My sins were deep, and they used to just clap. Sing glory, glory, hallelujah. Sing glory, glory, hallelujah. Sing glory, glory, hallelujah. When the Lord sets me free, my sins were higher than a mountain. My sins were higher. And they used to clap and sing, my sins were higher than a mountain. When the Lord set me free, my sins deeper than an ocean. My sins set me free. That's all. So it used to touch me. It used to really, really touch my heart. And one day there was a preacher who preached about hell and heaven. He touched me. I started to ask for his mom. Is she in hell? Is she in heaven? At that moment, I remember I had a dream when we were in a line going to heaven.
Yes.
And there was a certain rock, like a stone. If you step on it, then it swings, it drops you to the left, you wail. People would wail. Then if it drops you to the right, you celebrate. So I reached on that rock, and it was swinging me to the left, and then I woke up. I went to this preacher, Pastor Stephen, same form, saying, I had a weird dream, I was going to hell, and he's like, you need to surrender your life to Jesus. God loved our school because he sent him, there was another pastor, Isaac, Chiwewe, Stephen, Full Gospel Church, all those pastors, even you were the young one. We used to enjoy your time, not because you're here, but you were young, you could really understand us, we were really stubborn, and you had So we enjoyed you preaching. Every time you were preaching, everybody, the room would be very packed because challengers, and I remember Wilfred repenting. So I walked down the aisle and I gave my life to Jesus. because I wanted to go to heaven. Mm-hmm. I surrendered. I told him, God, forgive me. Mm-hmm. Wash me with your blood. Mm-hmm. Write my name in the book of life. Mm-hmm. I don't to be rebellious anymore. Mm-hmm. Take me to heaven. Because mm-hmm. I wasn't even sure whether we were going to live long because everybody was dying. Yes. And that day, it was like a big load, a big burden mm-hmm. taken off my shoulders. Mm-hmm. I had this joy that I still have. Mm-hmm. I lost appetite for money, mm-hmm. women, mm-hmm. fame, because mm-hmm. we're in school.